A signal drifts through the dark. Faint, ancient, unstoppable, alien in nature. It could have left its world before humans even learned to speak, and yet it might arrive here tonight. What would we do if it did? Who decides what we say back? And what if the universe has already said hello, and we just weren't listening? In the darkness, deep in the vastness of space, between stars, one fragile world learned to dream. We mapped its continents, traversed its seas, learned to conquer its cloud-dappled skies. But every horizon we master reveals another, just a little further beyond our reach. Now we design futures, worlds we have yet to touch. Join the blueprint. What comes next is ours to shape. For decades, humanity has been listening, pointing vast dishes at the sky. We've sifted through the static of the cosmos, searching for something, anything, that doesn't sound like nature. In 1977, one such signal appeared, a brief, powerful burst from the constellation Sagittarius. It lasted just 72 seconds. The data looked almost too perfect. A narrowband transmission, exactly the kind a civilization might send. 6EQUJ5. One astronomer circled it in red ink and wrote a single word: wow. And for a moment, the world wondered, had we just heard someone else? But the signal never repeated. We pointed our telescopes back again and again. Nothing. Maybe it was cosmic noise. Maybe something human. Or maybe it was our first missed call from the stars. Yet the wow signal changed everything. It taught us that even silence can be a message, one that pushes us to listen harder. Today, SETI scans billions of frequencies every second with arrays like Meerkat and the Allen Telescope Array. Each night, the data flows in, and somewhere in that ocean of numbers could be our first cosmic handshake. The more we listen, the more the universe feels less like a void and more like a question, waiting for us to find the words. If we ever do hear a signal, who answers? There are rules for this, real ones. Scientists under the International Academy of Astronautics have drafted what's called the post-detection protocols. The first step is verification. Rule out earthly interference. Confirm with independent observatories. Then, the findings go public. No secrecy, no hidden transmissions. But the most important rule is silence. No one is allowed to respond. Not a government, not a company, not a single scientist. Until the world decides together. That silence clause exists for a reason. Because replying isn't just a scientific act. It's a civilizational one. Some scientists think waiting is a mistake. They argue we should be the ones to speak first. Groups like METI, Messaging Extraterrestrial Intelligence, have already sent carefully crafted signals into space. Pulses of prime numbers, simple mathematical patterns, digital art. Critics say it's reckless, that you don't shout into the forest without knowing what's out there. Others see it as an act of hope, proof that we're ready to join the cosmic conversation. But before we can speak, we have to decide what to say and how to say it. And now a quick word from our sponsor, the drawing board. Because even in the void, Civilization runs on support. Still wearing mass-market clothes that say nothing about what you stand for? Meet The Drawing Board, a collector-driven designer fashion label that fuses future-forward streetwear with high-concept speculative futurism. Every limited edition drop is a self-contained story, bold, intentional, and built for tomorrow. It's not fabric, it's a manifesto you can wear. Try it for yourself, and wear the change you wish to see in the world. Imagine trying to talk to a mind that evolved under a different sun. No shared words. No shared biology. Only physics. And time. For scientists, the obvious starting point is mathematics. The one language we believe every civilization must share. Prime numbers. Geometric ratios. The structure of atoms. Universal truths, or so we hope. In 1974, a radio dish in Puerto Rico fired a pulse of binary light toward the Hercules cluster. 1,679 bits of data. Within those bits, the double helix of DNA, the map of our solar system, and a crude outline of a human being. Arms raised, like a species introducing itself to infinity. That was the Arecibo message, our first mathematical handshake with the cosmos. A few years later, we sent something more poetic, a golden record, bolted to the sides of the Voyager probes, carrying greetings in 55 languages, the sound of rain, a mother's laugh, and the music of Bach and Chuck Berry. It was less an instruction manual and more a love letter. A message not of data, but of emotion. But here's the problem. Every message we send says as much about us as it does about the universe. Even math isn't neutral. The way we count assumes we have fingers. Our universal chemistry assumes carbon, water, and warmth. Even our concept of hello assumes that communication is wanted. So when we beam a signal into the dark, we're not just saying we exist. We're saying this is how we think. This is how we see reality. And maybe that's the real test of contact. Not whether we can be understood, but whether we're ready for the universe to understand us. Let's say it happens. A verified signal. Structured. Repeating. Impossible to dismiss. A voice from another civilization. What happens after hello? On paper, there's no planetary ambassador, no emergency protocol for speaking to another world. The closest thing we have is the United Nations Office for Outer Space Affairs, an organization that helps manage orbit, lunar treaties, and the peaceful use of space. But a conversation across light years isn't a treaty. It's a test, not of technology, but of character. Who gets to answer? Governments? Scientists? A global vote? Even now, SETI researchers quietly debate. If a signal were confirmed tomorrow, would we announce it publicly? Or keep it secret to avoid panic? Contact could unite us like nothing else in history. A shared awakening that dissolves borders and makes us mean everyone on Earth. Or it could do the opposite. Power, fear, and ideology could fracture our response. Nations might compete to claim the message, decode it first, or weaponize what it reveals. Carl Sagan believed that contact would force us to grow up, to see ourselves as one civilization among billions, humbled and transformed. Stephen Hawking feared it could end us, that a more advanced intelligence might treat us as we treat ants beneath our feet. Both may be right, because every first contact story, real or imagined, isn't really about them. It's about us, our hopes, our fears, our longing to matter in a universe that is never answered back. And maybe that's the real revelation. Our first contact might not tell us who's out there, but who we've become while we were listening. If tomorrow a message from the stars reached Earth, we might all gather around the same signal, the same silence, waiting for someone to speak first. But first contact isn't about aliens. It's about us. Whether we choose fear or curiosity, division or unity, silence or speech. Because the moment we decide to answer, we're no longer just inhabitants of Earth. We become participants in a larger story, one that began long before us and will outlast our sun. If that journey speaks to you, leave a comment, share your thoughts, and subscribe. Because this story is just beginning, and you're part of it. Next time, we look beyond the stars and beyond ourselves. What happens when humanity begins to change? Our bodies, our minds, even our definition of life itself. From gene-edited astronauts to digital immortals, we explore what it means when the explorers evolve. This is Architects of the Void, and our conversation with the cosmos has only just begun.